Yeah.
She's a really very likable person. It can't be too. It can't be too far out in the country because she lives by bicycle. She takes bicycle and she's just starting a job at Half Price Books in East Town Mall. And so she takes the bus. No, she takes the bus out to there. That's a pretty long trek.
So when does she want to please?
From Sunday until May 15th.
What Sunday? What
is this coming up Sunday.
April 22nd or something. Yeah. 22nd, 23rd,
something. She must really like that.
I'm running.
Is that the...
No.
Is that the furnace? That's a jet plane.
That's a jet plane. I'm just saying, I started going, so that.
All right. She gives me that look. What's going on? My goodness.
No, I'm sorry, I'm late. I forgot my books.
Oh, yeah. You've gone from railroad clothes to lace. What kind of business?
This is an old lady mohair sweater.
Yes, it is.
Cozy.
All right. We are looking at Uranus. And now we are going to have two more meetings. We'll get through Neptune and Pluto, and then we'll be a long recess until late next September, and then we will go through the aspects, and then everybody has to work harder, including me. So these last three meetings of this year, we're looking at octave planets. And the thing about octave planets is that all of them are very unpredictable. Because all of them in some way or another represent things that are transcendental. And being transcendental, their home is outside of the realm of cause and consequence. They're not stuck in the ongoing train of things. And what they do is they bring in things that have never been there before. And Uranus especially is that way. If you want to look at the quotient of creativity in a horoscope, as much as it can be told, because creativity itself transcends astrology, but you want to look for the quotient of creativity in a horoscope, you look to Uranus. Because Uranus tells you whether somebody's going to do something new, or they're going to do something in a different way, or whether they're going to actually be a vehicle of the coming wave or of the future. So Uranus is extremely futuristic, and the way it works is it doesn't just usher in the future, it doesn't usher in something new, it does it creatively. If it is artistic, if it's the person is basically Venusian in character, it's likely to be artistic creativity. If they're more inclined toward martial things, it's more likely to be ingenious kind of creativity. That is, it's likely to be inventive. It's an extremely inventive planet. So the first sentence reads, I express creativity, ingenuity, inventiveness, innovation in spontaneous or improvisational activities in blank blank. So all of the words that are more than three letters long in that sentence are Uranus keywords. And it really is that. I've worked and met some very ingenious Uranian types. I worked with a man once. His name was a very unusual name. It was an Uranian name. His name was Aaron Fried Kolarsi. And he owned at one time what every Uranian type of person wants to own. He owned a junkyard. And when he retired from a junkyard, he went to a spiritual center where I was working at the time. And there were a lot of older people there who were retired and doing the work because that's all the organization could afford because it was impoverished and probably always will be impoverished. And these old ladies kept having problems and he had to fix them up. Like, you know, like it was not an irregular thing that somebody would call him up and say, I flushed my false teeth down the toilet. Can you retrieve them for me? And it's that kind of thing. And he had and afflicted Uranus, because everything that he fixed went bad after he fixed it. And his fixing was part of a haywire that made things worse than they were before. I have that. I happen to have a very inventive side to me, but my inventions are so irregular and so out of the way of things that, like, they're wacky. And mine is actually even a Rube Goldberg-like kind of inventiveness. Does anybody know who Rube Goldberg was? Yeah, he had those kinds. Like, he had a special alarm clock that when the sun would get to a certain height, it would shine through a lens, and it would then shine on the behind of the lady across the street, who would jump up. And when she would jump up, she would frighten the birds outside of the window, who would do their business, which was just enough to tip a lever, and that lever would... It was that kind of thing, until something really funny happened, like it tipped over a pile of tin cans and then you were waked up. Uranus is a very interesting planet, but I guess we'll get into more and more as we go on. Aries in the first house. I got these turned around. All right, I'll just have to do it the other way. I express creativity through flashy surroundings and improvisational activities in flashy surroundings. Or I express ingenuity in spontaneous activity in nouveau riche settlements. Anybody for Bishop's Bay? Or I express innovation in improvisational activity in zippy cataloging. Or I express inventiveness in spontaneous activity in exotic cooking. Or I express creativity in spontaneous activity in dazzling self-expressions. Uranus loves to dazzle. It's got very much of a Luciferian quality about it. Together with the Sun or Mars, it loves to be a show-off. With Uranus in Virgo and the sixth house, it expresses ingenuity through spontaneous activity in deft details. Or in Libra and the seventh house, I express ingenuity and creativity in stylized marriage, which means one after another. With Uranus in the seventh house, it isn't so much of the type of marriage partner, it's more or less the, the trajectory of marriage partners that someone goes through, each being more creative than the last. I have a friend that lost control of his life. He was an alcoholic. And from the age of about 11 until he died in his early 40s, he never had a sober month. He worked construction, and when he told the boss, "I need to take a break for a Coke," he meant something to what the boss thought when he said a Coke break. He did cocaine and heroin and angel's dust and a psilocybin, everything you could think of, and he came out the other end as a alcoholic. And then he lived on Williamson Street until he started to get his act cleaned up and his handwriting cleared up, and he actually started looking good again. And then under a new moon, he tried one last binge, and he went unconscious. And 2 weeks later, in the full moon, he had pancreas, kidney, and liver. They all just completely stopped down. But in his quest to have self-control, you often marry what you aren't. And so he kept marrying tougher and tougher women who had more and more control. The last one he married actually fought it out with a bear in Alaska. And he, it never went on consciously in his mind, but unconsciously in his mind, he was hoping, oh, maybe this is the one that's going to put me in line. it was fantastically interesting to watch. Before that, it was a trainer of what are those big black dogs?
Dobermans?
No, not Dobermans, but something like that. Not Persicanarias either.
Great Dane?
No.
What?
Rottweilers. Oh. Yes. Yeah. And he figured any woman who can train a Rottweiler can train me. All right, Miss Scorpio and eighth house. I express creativity in spontaneous eliciting of hidden schemes. Or Sagittarius and ninth house. I express ingenuity in and innovation in enlightened aspirations. Or Capricorn and the 10th house, I express ingenuity in slick mastery. And then we have the classic, Uranus in Aquarius. And the 11th house, I express innovation in free utopianism. And in Pisces and the 12th house, I express inventiveness via believing in unknown things. All right. As we said right at the very beginning, this is an unpredictable planet, probably the most unpredictable of all. It's a funny thing. You can predict a time when a person is going to act in an Uranian fashion, but you can't predict what the new thing is going to be. It's like saying you can predict periods when novelty is likely, but you don't know what the novelty is, because if you did, you would have a different kind of a consciousness. You would have a consciousness that was attuned to the creative psyche of the cosmos, knowing what was to come, right? So the next sentence reads, irregular, uncontrolled, unpredictable, unreliable actions in blank blank could result in sudden, unexpected, daft upsets. It's the planet of upsets. Again, all of the small words, except for could result, all of the large words except could result are Uranian keywords. This is not the positive side of Uranus, it's the negative side. Some people can't tell the difference. If a person is really creative, some people think it's just luck, and they think some things are just happening. And this is the kind of thing, the ingenuity of taking your creative skill and hiding it from someone else is what keeps pool sharks healthy. It keeps them in money, because they can always make it look like, my goodness, I just lucked out, look what happened. But if you are not in control of the lower planets, that is the fundamental planets, it's much, much harder to be in control of the active planets. And when you get out of control of the active planets, anything can happen. Uranus is considered highly irregular, especially if it's in, like it is now, in a common sign. If, you know, anything goes, is like, could be a good pair of keywords for Uranus, because anything can and will happen. All right. I can express irregular actions in preemptive procurement and have unexpected results. Or I can express uncontrollability in indeterminate shipping and have sudden results. Or I can express unreliable actions in hooky real estate deals, and they could produce daft upsets. In Cancer and the fifth house, I could produce unpredictable events through slipshod presentation, and it would result in sudden unexpected things. Or in Leo and the sixth house, I can be uncontrolled in showy routines, and the result could be sudden unexpected things. Or in Virgo in the seventh house, I could be uncontrollable in neurotic sharing, and the result could be unexpected. Or in Libra and the eighth house, I could be unpredictable in unbalanced legacies. Or with Scorpio and the ninth house, I could be uncontrolled in racy travels. Or I could be Sagittarius, I could be irregular about high-blown scandals with Sagittarius in the 10th house. They really tell stories. I had great fun putting together the words, because the game was that you never repeat yourself and you try to make something that is appropriate to the sentence that you're working with, yet at the same time producing words that you can use anywhere in any of the sentences. And it was the time of my life. I spent hours at it every week. In Capricorn in the 11th house, I can be unpredictable in compressed daydreaming. Or Aquarius in the 12th house, I can be unreliable due to random limitations, and it produces unexpected results. Or in Pisces and the first house, I am irregular about wavering challenges. All right. Blank about blank, the second blank therefore has to be a house blank, helps me to develop a sense of mystical, spiritual feeling, receptive, direct, knowing, faith, or the cosmic feminine. We're talking about here that on the higher octave level, Uranus is a feminine planet. It deals with mysticism. On the physical level, it is a technical planet. But even as a technical planet, it does things by feeling and it doesn't think things through. It has intuitive dead reckoning. I at one time knew a computer programmer who had Uranus in Gemini, and that was his calling. And the way he debugged software was he would have listings, pages and pages of listings, and he would run his hand over the listings until he felt the spot where there was a bug. And he was reliable, and he got his job done. It was really unusual. But at any rate, what we're trying to get at this in this sentence is we're talking about the higher octave of Uranus. Now, in our society, we don't find much of the higher octave of Uranus. We have very few pure mystics, people who approach life completely by devotion and have faith and belief in anything, you know, and will walk around for the rest of their life living off of the alms of other people. We have people living off of alms, but and they are a little unusual, but it isn't because of faith, it's because of necessity. But what we're talking about here is the mystical. The mystical is receptive. The mystic believes that God is good and that Krishna will provide. And so they're just accepting of everything. It is the type of person that doesn't need spiritual answers. It just needs continuously to increase its faith. And if something mysterious is presented to this type of psychology, it doesn't try to solve the mystery. It just takes that as a sign that it has to have more faith so that the mystery will itself be revealed to it. To think about it or work at it is not the nature of a mystic. All right, again, we don't want to be too long. I don't think we're ever going to get one of these done in an hour. But now when we start getting next year, when we start getting writing sentences, and I have to read all the sentences of the class, you can be sure that it's going to be a short class. Of course, from Julie, we're expecting something with high literacy. All right, with Aries and the third house, incentive about writings could help me develop a sense of the mystical. Or Taurus and the fourth house, certainty about acceptance could help me to develop spiritual feeling. Or Gemini and the fifth, reflexiveness about celebration could help me to develop faith. Or paradoxes about helping could help me to experience direct knowing. In Leo and the seventh house, heartache about interactiveness could help me to understand the cosmic feminine. For men especially, the seventh house is important for coming to the knowledge of the cosmic feminine. Efficiency in solutions could help me to develop a sense of feeling. Or serenity about beliefs could put me in touch with the cosmic feminine. Or in Scorpio and the 10th house, intense faith in matters of statecraft could help me develop faith. Or credulity about egalitarianism could help me to develop a sense of receptivity. Or simplicity about the gods could help me to develop a sense of the mystical. Or wisdom about first impressions could help me to develop direct knowing. Or yearning for quality or about quality could lead me to the cosmic feminine. All right. The fourth one is not meant to be negative, but some people would consider the early set of keywords to be positive and some would consider them to be negative. Blank attitudes toward oddballs, bohemians, artists, romantics, or romantics in matters of blank are key to developing open-mindedness, originality, and acceptance of new things. I happen to like odd people. They're not, odd people are different than strange. Strange comes next week. But oddballs, just highly irregular people. Bohemians, you know, I knew a guy, he literally called himself Bohemian Bob Schweda. And he was an artist, and he owned a storefront in Milwaukee. He kept getting more and more creative and doing stranger and stranger things in his art until he decided that he was not attracting the attention that was due to him. So he proceeded to sit in the window of the storefront and make faces at people as they walked by. This was his form of performance art. And mind you, this was in about 1960, when performance art, Laurie Anderson was a little girl at that time yet. But he still didn't give enough attention, so he decided to go one up on them, and he decided to sit in the window of his storefront nude and make faces with people, which is when the police raided, and that was the end of that. It was interesting, you know, the guy was odd, and he just liked doing odd things, and he liked having odd friends, and we hit it off right away, because I was pretty odd myself at that time, and had a very different take on things. Artists, in order to create, you live what you create. And this is, we're not talking a school of David here, where you try to be perfectly representational. We're talking about, if you're creative, you want everything in your life to be creative, even the way you put your jam on your toast in the morning. And so that's what we're trying to get at. Romantics. And by romantics, we don't mean boy-girl romance. We mean a high-blown poetic romance. You know, women with milk-white skin and tigers that are so fierce that they're hot to even be near, or something like that kind of thing. Of course, Uranus is the planet of open-mindedness. You cannot create unless you're open-minded. And intuitions are like interruptions in your life. And if you're looking at someone's handwriting, if you want to see somebody who is creative and inventive, you look for, if they're writing, they'll have breaks between the letters that aren't normally there in normal script. And when those breaks are there, this is the kind of person who has a consciousness that is open. And that open-mindedness is the consciousness that creativity comes in. And originality. It doesn't try to be first. It just likes original things. And that is for both senses of the word original. It can mean the original, meaning the first from the past. Sometimes an Iranian person can take things that are so orthodox that they make those orthodox things unorthodox, you know, the way they originally were. And it's key to the acceptance of new things. Some people have a very, very hard time with the acceptance of new things. I remember one time I was taking a Greyhound bus home from Tucson, Arizona to here, and the bus had problems, and I was the smallest person. And so I had to crawl in over the engine and flick a little lever for the bus driver, but it didn't get it started. So what they did is they took everybody from the bus to this little tiny town in Oklahoma. Now, mind you, I had rag bottom pants, and I was wearing flip-flops as my ordinary shoes, and I had long hair and a beard. And we're in this tiny, very reactionary, this is earlier yet, this is about, I would say, 1958 or 59. And the town is so backwards, they don't have concrete sidewalks. On Main Street, they've got boardwalks to keep you so that you're not in either the dust or in the mud. And so here I come walking down the sidewalk in sandals and all of that. And the old timers are sitting in front of a general store. And they got so mad, they couldn't accept something new and they couldn't accept something different. They got so mad that they just went like, they spit, because they didn't know what else to do, because they couldn't handle something different. They couldn't handle something, which of course, being Iranian as I was at the time, I loved it. Man, I wanted the reaction, and I got it. It was some kind of opposites attract kind of a thing there. All right. We are this time with Aries in the fourth house. Affirmative attitudes toward Bohemians in matters of instincts are key to developing open-mindedness. Or assurant attitudes toward creative people in matters of pleasure are key to developing originality. Or lenient attitudes in matters of work help develop an acceptance of new things with Bohemian people. Or casual attitudes in matters with Bohemian peoples in matters of etiquette help me to develop an acceptance of new things. Yes. It's interesting to watch the reactions of people because you can see what kind of scenarios or remembrances are coming to people's minds. It's free association. Please do so. Leo and the eighth house, promotive attitudes toward oddballs in matters of poverty are a way of developing originality, or facilitating attitude toward creative people in matters of wanderings is a way to develop open-mindedness, or congenial attitude toward odd people in matters of prestige is a way to accept new things. Or in Scorpio and the 11th house, caustic attitudes toward romantics in matters of universality is a way of developing an acceptance of new things. Or avuncular attitudes toward creative people in matters of strangers or aliens is a way of accepting new things. Or inflective attitudes toward bohemians in matters of leadership are key to developing open-mindedness. Or equal attitudes toward unusual people in matters of objectification are key to developing acceptance. Or bizarre attitudes toward oddballs in matters of delegation are key to developing acceptance. All right, we are at sentence number 5. Blank opportunities, that means the first blank is a house blank, of a blank nature help me to deal with intensity, electric, temperamental explosiveness, and violence. We're talking about things that are of a quantum level of energy above what we normally experience. And it is possible, if you are extremely deft and extremely disciplined and fluent, to bring in new things and not have explosive or electric things happen. For example, if you are non-resistant at all, you can sit down at a piano and you can spontaneously create. And everything is new. It's never been done before. There used to be a piano player here at the university. What was his name? No. He was artist in residence for about 20 years. And he actually wrote piano concertos spontaneously. He would sit down. He would say, how long do you want it to be? And he would sit down for 40 minutes. And in good classical music style, he would sit down and just spontaneously improvise a piano concerto. What was his name? I forget his name now. He was a real treat. And he fledged a whole bunch of very good piano players out of this school. Oh, well. All right. Blank opportunities. All right. We're dealing with energy. We're dealing with spark plugs. We're dealing with things that come in that are so new and so shocking and so different that they overturn everything. It's another kind of saying of an upset. Where Uranus is, there is amazing intensity. I had an Uranus experience once. It was really quite something. Very early in the morning, I was debugging electronics for my job, and I took 2,700 or 3,000 volts in a shock. It was at a microamp, but I took that, And it was an intense experience like you've never had before. It burned a hole right in my hand. But what happens, it doesn't burn from the outside. It burns from the inside. When the electricity hits the electrolytes, it causes the heat, and then it just boils, and it boils a hole right out of your hand. But you know, I didn't need coffee to wake up that morning. it's the kind of thing that you just zap. And discoveries are like that. When something completely new that you've never ever seen before, something that's unprecedented to you, comes in, it is shocking. And that's what we're trying to get at here. We're dealing with temperamentality. Because again, the kind of personality that is open to that, or that you might say resonates to that, or is harmonious to that, is a volatile type of personality. And so if there's a strong Uranian nature, there is a volatility in the person. That's a person who might be very, very creative, but it's the kind of person that will have those problems. This is where the legend comes of the temperamental artist. You know, it's almost archetypal that in order for a person to be an artist that you have to be temperamental. Well, what they're doing is they are tuning into the Iranian type of archetype. Now, there are artists that are not necessarily Iranian like that, but this is the one where somebody's doing something very different, a departure from everything that has come before that is indicated by Uranus. Yes?
Would Epiphany be
Yes, yes. Even Advent. yeah, I laid an egg, so it could be Easter. All right. Educational opportunities of an immediate nature help me to deal with intensity. Or conditioning opportunities of an intense nature help me to deal with explosiveness. Or defensive opportunities of a startling nature help me to deal with electric circumstances. Or purgative opportunities of a digestive nature help me to deal with violence, or transcendent opportunities of a glowing nature help me to deal with temperamentality, or political opportunities of a sticking nature help me to deal with explosiveness, or risky opportunities of a beckoning nature help me to deal with violence, or sacrificial opportunities of a painful nature help me to deal with violence. Scorpio is a very painful sign. Childhood opportunities of a heightened nature help me to develop, help me to work with temperamentality. Situated or grounded opportunities of a manipulative nature help me to deal with temperamentality. Or, boy, vicarious opportunities of a risky nature help me to deal with intensity. Or lowly opportunities of an uncanny nature help me to deal with creativity. Monday, I see whether I can get new eye lenses. I hope. I liberate, rebel from, or free blank, and am blank, socialistic, communistic, radical, revolutionary, libertarian, or anarchical. Uranus rules all of those outlooks on life. Socialism, because it's altruistic and it believes everyone is equal. communistic because it even believes in even more equality, so that everything is that way. Radical, meaning that the bringing in of socialism or communism has to be done in an extreme way. Radicality is, revolutionary is the same way. Libertarians and anarchists are also ruled by Uranus. And they are, they're lovable people, but they certainly have some odd ideas. Libertarians get these ideas. The first thing that you can tell that you're dealing with an Uranus person is they don't want to pay tax. They are, they might be socialistic in that they believe that everyone is their brother and that everybody is their equal, and they might be very egalitarian, at least in mind, but once you ask them to pay taxes for the sake of the needy or to pay taxes for the highways that we all use immediately, it's no. And the kind of action that it takes is liberational action. Let me free things. Let me rebel from things. And that is the Iranian way of doing things. It is the living, dying rebel. Now you recognize, of course, that these are the revolutionaries, but they are not the people who are instituted after the revolution is over. It's the Mars and Uranus hotheads that do all of the rebelling, and it is the Saturnian, the Capricorn types of people that take over afterwards. Like Lenin might be, or Molotov, they might be bomb throwers, but who succeeds them? Stalin, you know. Stalin was so paranoid that when he signed his name, he put a period after it. And when you, if you're looking at someone, say, oh, for some reason or another, tonight is handwriting night, and I don't know why. But if people put periods where periods don't belong, that's a pretty good tip that a person is moving in the direction of paranoia, especially after their signature. If they put a period there, that means, hey, this, look out for this guy. And they, you may get a violent reaction from the paranoid feelings that the person has inwardly. All right. I liberate slaves and am blatantly socialistic with the sun and with Uranus in Aries and the sixth house. I am, I rebel against commitment and I am doggedly socialistic. I free myself from debtors and I am clearly libertarian. I rebel from dogmatism and I am treacherously revolutionary. I liberate people from superiors and I am a full-blooded radical. In Leo, everything with Leo is in the blood. I rebel against everything, and I am precisely libertarian. Or I rebel against general problems, and I am an armchair radical. Or I liberate the appearances, and I am menacingly communistic. Or I liberate myself, or I rebel against clinging, and I am generally libertarian. Or I liberate myself from dialogue, and I am demandingly radical. Or I free myself from hand-me-downs, and I am naturally anarchical. Or I rebel against lovers, and I am perversely radical. All right. This next sentence is very important, especially if you are seeking spiritually. You're wanting to be awakened, and Uranus is the awakener. It is the planet of Satori. It is the planet of sudden enlightenment. And so the next sentence reads, my spot is of greatest awakening or sudden awareness or understanding is with blank, and it helps me to learn originality, freedom, independence, impersonal progressive attitudes by the quality of blank. Quality means that the second blank is assigned blank. So we're talking about, if you're looking following transits or progressions or things like that, and you're seeing a person who's building up the tension of someone who is, you know, like what they call stringing the bow in mystical literature, because as you string the bow and then as you pull it back, the tension builds up and up and up, and then at just the right moment, you have a sudden awakening. This is not, we're not talking about gradually moving into the ethers and the higher worlds. That's Neptune. We're talking about something that happens like a snap, sudden. Zen Buddhism is very much an Iranian kind of thing. They go to great extremes. The classical case with Zen Buddhism is the master has a disciple, and the disciple was at the gate, and the gate's sort of like in feudal times, huge, big, massive gate, and the disciple wants in, and he's ready. He's at the moment of readiness, and so when he starts walking in, the master closes the gate again and crushes his leg, and he's a gimp for the rest of his life, but at just that moment in experiencing the pain, the master knew that this is what would happen and produce his enlightenment. And that's when he had his Satori experience. I myself am not really too much in favor of maiming legs, especially if you have to misjudge the the readiness of the pupil. But you see what I'm trying to get at. It's a eureka moment. Johannes Kepler had a eureka moment. He was proving the relationship of, if you'd have an equilateral triangle, and he was proving through geometric means the proportion of the relationship of the diameter of an inscribed circle that's inscribed in an equilateral triangle versus the circumference of circle that goes around the same equilateral triangle. He was put this proof up on the board and he started working on it. All of a sudden he recognized that that proportion was the proportion of the relationship of the orbit of Saturn to the orbit of Jupiter. And then he had this eureka moment, and he spent all the rest of his life trying to find out what kind of geometric figures would produce the orbits of all of the different planets. He believed in some kind of cosmic harmony. He was sort of like a latter-day Pythagorean. And he had this wonderful sphere where he had the orbit of Saturn, and then he had a geometric figure of, he used the Platonic solids. And then inside of that was another sphere, and inside of that was another geometric solid. It was really quite beautiful. And then he took it into numbers, and he actually tried to get the music of the spheres, and he was really very close to exactly right. But it's that kind of a moment when you're suddenly there and everything changes. You're aware of everything. And, you know, I actually did find out this week, I think I mentioned it in one of these three classes, but I don't know which one it was. Newton actually did talk about his discovery of universal gravitation was when he saw an apple fall from a tree, and he asked himself the simple question, why does it always fall perfectly vertically to the ground and not sideways or spiraling or something like that? I don't know that he got hit on the head by the apple, but it actually was from a falling apple, which proves that astrology is right, because he has Libra rising in his horoscope, which would indicate a proximity to apples. All right. My spot of greatest awakeness is with enemies, and they help me to learn freedom through the quality of singularity. Keeping one enemy at a time. My spot of greatest sudden awareness is with debts, and it helps me to learn progressive attitudes through integrity. Or my spot of greatest sudden understanding is with generalization. And it helps me to develop impersonality through, where am I here? Indifferent generalization. All right, my spot of sudden awareness is with fame, and it helps me to develop freedom through the quality of reflection. My spot of greatest awareness is in elections, and it helps me to learn originality by self-awareness. My spot of greatest understanding is in everything, and I develop impersonal attitudes through precision. Or my spot of greatest awakening is in firsthand experience, and I develop progressive attitudes through liberality. My spot of greatest understanding is in evaluation, and I develop freedom through the attitude of ultimate motivation. My spot of greatest awareness is with the media, and I develop independence through transcendence. Or my spot of greatest understanding is with family, and I develop progressive attitudes through conscience. Or my spot of sudden awareness is with affection, and I develop progressiveness through attitudes of evolution. My spot of greatest awakening is with fabrication, and I develop freedom through clairvoyance. All right. The sentence number 8 deals with the most negative side of Uranus, and there are it's quite creative in the different keywords it has attracted to itself, because there are a lot of different ways that one can be a negative Uranian. Blank perversity, stubbornness, unconventionality, licentiousness, impulsive egoism focused on blank is a likely source of fanaticism, vampirism, mania, or crackpot tendencies. By perversity, it is meant deviation. If you're doing something new that's never been there before, it's off the records. It's off the scale. It's off of what is considered normal, or what is even considered, and that kind of behavior is always considered perverse. And the funny thing about it is that if you have an enlightening experience that you know is true, if you have only one, or if you force yourself to have only one by hanging on to it forever and ever, it leads to a strange kind of stubbornness. Sometimes the most original people become the most stubborn people, because they know the truth of something. and they don't have the security or they don't have the wisdom to say, well, I know the truth of this, maybe I can learn the truth of something more if I just let go and try something different or try something new. Unconventional, in fact, it's deliberate unconventionality. It'll do anything. And sometimes if you put it together with something like Venus or Jupiter or something like that, Uranus takes on the quality of, I am a free person, I can do whatever I want. And that can be something licentious. I can, you know, I can live a libertine life and I'm above it all. I've actually met people who were Uranian types that believed that they could smoke and that they were invulnerable to lung cancer because they were above it all because of their mysticism. It's that kind of a thing. Impulsive egoism, where you have to prove yourself. I begin to identify with being different. You begin to identify with being new. And therefore, if you want to prove that you are still you, and you're locked in your egoism and nothing new can come in, you act with desire impulses in place. And that's what we're trying to get at with impulsive egoism. Fanaticism. If this be true, why study anything else? It's that kind of attitude. Once you know the truth of something, you don't want to go back to a different kind of life. You've had that experience. Vampirism is a negation of the spiritual feminine. In the same way that the spiritual feminine can be receptive, it can also be an energy sucker. Usually if you find Uranus in a negative aspect with Saturn and Pluto and throw in the moon for good measure, you've got somebody who's a psychic vampire and who will draw all the energy out of you like one pat on the shoulder is equal to a full day's work. I used to work with this friend of mine and I, I'd like to meet him again. I haven't seen him now in 40 some years. I can't even remember his name now. But we worked around a place where there was a psychic vampire who was named Gertrude. And Gertrude thought we were such nice young men, but every time Gertrude came up and patted us on the shoulder, we slumped. She had the ability, she felt sorry for herself. And she didn't even know she was doing it. In her feeling sorry for herself, she thought she was doing a good thing by patting these nice young men on the shoulder. But what she was really doing was drawing energy off of us. And then we used to sit around and try to devise ways that we could evade Gertrude. Oh, his name was Curtis. I believe he's somewhere in the Los Angeles area now. He was a real creative guy. I met him, he worked where I worked, and he said, I just came here straight from the 12th house. He said, I met my Neptune man, and he got busted. Which means saying he came to work there straight after he got out of jail because he was making a buy and his dealer was arrested and he was arrested in it. Boy, we're going awfully slow here, aren't we? All right. Bold perversity focused on secrecy is a likely source of fanaticism. Or obsessive stubbornness focused on ceremony is a likely source of mania. Or fickle unconventionality focused on ends is a likely source of vampirism. Or hyper-emotional licentiousness focused, I'm on the wrong line here. Loony licentiousness focused on do-gooding is a source of crackpot tendencies. Or self-centered unconventionality focused on impairments is a likely source of vampirism for me. She's in a wheelchair. She can't get away. All right. Particular perversity focused on personal inclinations is a likely source of fanaticism. Or vain stubbornness focused on possession is a likely source of vampirism. Or luciferic perversity focused on fanaticism, focused on introversion is a likely form of a fanaticism. Speculative licentiousness focused on withdrawals is a likely source of crackpot tendencies. Or inverted unconventionality focused on matters of speculation is a likely source of mania. Or exhibitionist perversity focused on health is a likely source of crackpot ideas. Or, this is in Pisces and the seventh house, debasing stubbornness focused on luxury is a likely source of vampirism. Oh, buy me those jewels, honey. All right. Sentence number 9. I can develop a sense of hunches, speculation, satori, paradox, intuition, and irrationality, or the infinite in general on blank blank. Again, all different sides of Uranus. Well, I guess we have the idea of hunches as being one form of intuition. Speculation as being one form of using intuition to something that isn't a matter of experience. The spiritual feminine works by paradox, meaning to say that in the seam between something being true and its extreme opposite being true, in that seam is where creative intuition comes. This is where Goethe's theory of light comes. Goethe's theory of light is that it is in the interaction of light and darkness that all color comes into being. Irrationality. Irrationality does not mean unrational or subrational. It can mean that, but it can just as well mean suprarational. There's something about the irrational that can go beyond ordinary consciousness. And Uranus deals with the infinite. Not necessarily the eternal, but the infinite, something that goes on and on and on. All right. I can develop a sense of intuition through frenzied striving. Or Taurus and the 10th house, I can develop a sense of speculation through all-inclusive administration. Or Gemini in the 12th house. 11th. Gemini in the 11th house. All right. I can develop a sense of paradox through vibrant dispersonalization. Or I can develop a sense of irrationality through hyper-emotional restraints. Or I can develop a sense or an experience of satori through total trials. Or I can develop a sense of hunches through sparkling acquisitions. Or I can develop a sense of intuition by anticipating arguments. Or I can develop a sense of speculation through introverting impressions. Or I can develop a sense of the infinite through divinely playful releases. Or I can develop a sense of overseeing or of the infinite. I can develop a sense of the infinite through overseeing processes. Or I can develop a sense of speculation through universal culture, or I can develop a sense of paradox by exploring the occult. All right.
An image, please?
Yes.
Vibrant dispersalization?
Yes. Being able to be excited without it having to mean something to you personally. So that's
it's not a matter of casting off.
It could be that, but it's a matter of coming alive by letting go of your personal experience or something. All right. Here we come to the lower octave part of Uranus, sentence number 10. It reads, I meet electrical or electronics people, mechanics, tinkerers, fixers, technicians, practical jokers, or scientists via blank blank, and they cultivate a feeling of genius, wisdom, wonder. You can even throw awe in there if you want. Might as well put another. I should be writing all these keywords in here so that the next edition can be better. We're dealing with people who like infernal machines, especially infernal machines that do not involve the assertion of energy. Mechanics is an Iranian thing, but electronics, where things are accomplished by invisible energies that all you have to do is channel, is an Iranian kind of thing. Uranus will do mechanics. I've looked at the horoscopes and have interviewed mechanics that have the Iranian nature very strong in them, and they don't figure it out mentally. They figure it out by intuitive dead reckoning. Almost anybody who works with electronics, I used to work around electronics technicians and electronics engineers, and almost all of them do it completely by intuition. They get the intuition of something being wrong, and then they figure out the logic comes afterwards. Uranus rules Aquarius, and Plato was an Aquarius, and that's the Iranian kind of thought. You get the intuition first, and then you backthink to where you were when you got the intuition and when you were trying to solve the problem. Altogether different than Neptunian kind of thinking, Aristotelian kind of thinking. Aristotelian thinking tries to move forward and tries to come to a conclusion from one thing following another. And the whole problem is that the causes fan out and you don't know which is which, whereas if you go with the intuitive dead reckoning, you know right away which is which. So we're talking then about people who are tinkers and fixers, and some of them like to do practical jokes. Mercury square Uranus is somebody that loves to do practical jokes kinds of things. And there are those things. One of the feelings of discovery, it's a minor experience of the life spirit, which means it's a minor experience of Christ. Very, very minor. But when you have that sense of wonder, like a little child has a sense of wonder, or if you have a sense of awe at the way things are unfolding, that is an Iranian kind of experience. It's taking you, you're getting at least an echo of life spirit. Wisdom. Despite all we've been saying about quirky people and things like that, a full-blown Iranian type of consciousness is wisdom. It isn't knowledge. It is knowledge plus that creative love that is behind all of the intuitions in the first place. Because that's what altruism is. It's loving somebody fresh, somebody new, every time you see them. Even if you've seen them 5 minutes ago, there's something creative in that. And that creative quality is a quality of love. You might say that in terms of the creation itself, of everything that comes into being, it is being loved into existence, because in that expression of that kind of love, there is always new creative intuition. And so that's what we're trying to get at. Awe is another one. It's like one of those things that just leaves you gape-mouthed. Your jaw drops when you experience something like that, and sometimes it comes from the most unexpected kinds of people. All right, we are looking here. I meet tinkerers via state-of-the-art businesses, and they cultivate in me a sense of wisdom. Or I meet technicians through compulsory happenings, and they develop a sense of awe in me. Or I meet mechanics via charged exiles, and they awaken in me a feeling of genius. Or I meet electrical people through curious contests, and they awaken a sense of wonder in me. Or Leo and the second house, I meet people via collecting originals, and they awaken in me a sense of wonder. Or I meet people through technical jaunts, and they awaken, cultivate a feeling of wisdom in me. Or I meet electrical people through countercultural retreats, and they awaken a sense of awe in me. I happen to like this set of keywords. I meet tinkerers via surreal parties. And surreal is a good word for Scorpio, Uranus and Scorpio. And they awaken a sense of wisdom in me. I meet fixers through divine service, and they awaken or cultivate a feeling of genius in me. I meet practical jokers through anti-conventional lawsuits, and they awaken a sense of wisdom in me. I meet scientists in the process of friendly divorce, and they awaken a sense of wonder in me. Or I meet technicians via exhaustive wayfaring, and they cultivate a sense of awe in me. All right, this is a neutral one again. That can be go either positive or negative. Vivid, striking, upsetting, blank attitudes, means it's a sign keyword, can lead to haphazardness, opinionation, fixity, or irresponsibility about blank. This is basically a repeat sentence using different words, but all of the concepts we've seen before tonight. It's very vivid, it's very, very striking. The experiences of Uranus never are muted. Even if there are heavy planets like Pluto or Saturn involved with Uranus, you would think that would mute it, but it doesn't. All it does is it puts the pressure on so that when Uranus does release itself, it just comes out with a stronger jolt. Uranus is one of those planets that's not going to be denied. This is the thing that throughout history has come again and again and again. People will not be denied freedom. The more they come to know themselves, the more free they're going to be. And you can try anything from physical coercion. Probably the strongest is cultural coercion. That's the way we're going to get rid of smoking, is when culture thinks that it's bad and you're looked on as something worse than a criminal for smoking. That's when that attitude is in general, it'll change the smoking in our society. But I lost my train of thought here, but if you try even with brainwashing to keep people from their freedom, it isn't going to work. And as history progresses forward, it's going to become more and more that way. Freedom is on the way. Haphazard, it sort of means that you're jumping from here to there to there, and Uranus goes by whatever moves its intuition. There is not an organization. You're dealing with a planet here that likes disorganization. And in that disorganization, it can do something that is very appropriate to its intuition. And it balks at the whole idea of having to do something through a regular routine. Creation and cosmos do not go very well together. Again, we find that fixity in opinion, and again, we find that irresponsibility. The irresponsibility being that the attitude is such that I am a creative person. Therefore, I belong to the gods. Therefore, I don't have to be responsible to anyone. It's that kind of logic in the consciousness of the person that, you know, all right. Ooh, we're in danger of running over 90 minutes. Yes. We are at Aries and the 11th house.
19 minutes.
Vivid attitudes. Vivid, searing attitudes can lead to opinionation about balloting or striking, upsetting attitudes, striking, jarring attitudes can lead to fixity about detention or upsetting. Unreliable attitudes can lead to haphazardness about imminence or striking splashy attitudes can lead to irresponsibility about interest or vivid self-evident attitudes can lead to fixity about expedience. Striking pseudo-intellectual attitudes can lead to haphazardness about home life. Or vivid disorienting attitudes can lead to opinionation about children. Or striking vehement attitudes can lead to irresponsibility about skills, or upsetting incredibility can lead to opinionation about promises, or striking imperial attitudes can lead to irresponsibility about death, or holistic vivid attitudes or vivid holistic attitudes can lead to opinionation about testimonial, or upsetting peculiar attitudes can lead to irresponsibility about specifications. We're just talking about that house. Who was that house in California where the widow had the fortune and the money would keep coming to her? Oh, she talked to her husband through a seance or something like that, and as long as she kept building on her house, she would live. And the moment she stopped building on her house, and there were secret rooms and staircases that led to nowhere, and she did this for most of the rest of her life. She was constantly rebuilding the house. And then she stopped, and then within a week she was dead. All right. What is really interesting is to know that you have that kind of a destiny. To know that you have that in the consciousness, you know. It's sort of, I wouldn't know how to astrologize that, because fish have to swim, because if they don't swim, they die. So would that be a Piscean thing, where if there's some kind of necessity that unless you keep doing it and doing it and doing it, I don't know. interesting thing. I guess if anybody can remember who the name of that lady was, who was in that conversation? Were you in that thing?
I remember this.
If anybody can remember who it is, I'd like to look up and see if I can get that horoscope. All right, we're doing the last sentence, which is always about medical things. I am likely to spasticity, stuttering, overexcitement, shock, or accidents with my blank, and quick, miraculous manifestations of wisdom, grace, altruism, or universal love in blank could be a source of healing. I think either you can go either way in all of this with the blanks, whether it's a sign or a house. Spasticity, irregularity, you don't know when it's coming. Stuttering, where you're trying to get so much out that the least little bit of holding back of that subtle stuff causes the stuttering. Overexcitement, I'm prone to all of those things. I have Uranus conjoined the dragon's tail, and I sometimes have a speech impediment. Shock, accidents. We're talking about electric shock here and not the state of shock, which is something else. We're talking here miraculous manifestations. We're talking about special things that come along and heal you. All right. I am likely to spastic accidents with my optic nerve, and altruism in piety could be a source of healing. Or I am likely to overexcitement with my voice, and grace could be a form, grace in initiation could be a source of healing. I have a word here that isn't, accidents due to my berating, I got a misspelling here, quick manifestations of universal love could be a source of healing through responsibilities, or stuttering about nourishment and manifestations of wisdom could lead to a source of healing of agreeing wisdom could be a source of healing. I am likely to spasticity with my spine, and wisdom applied by my parents could be a source of healing. Or I am likely to shock to my nerves, and universal love applied with generosity could be a form of healing. I am likely to accidents to my kidneys, and wisdom applied volitionally could be a source of healing. I am likely to spasticity in my colon, and vows to in grace could be a source of healing. I am likely to overexcitement of my sciatic nerve, and universal love applied in regeneration could be a source of healing. I am likely to shock intention, and miraculous manifestations of complementation could be a source of healing. Or I am likely to stuttering due to over-flexibility, and altruistic love applied to execution could be a source of healing. As an executive executes. I'm very likely to spasticity in emotional responses, and miraculous manifestations of grace from stepchildren or two stepchildren could be a source of healing. And it's it.
Is blushing?
What?
Is blushing a Uranian?
No.
It's moon?
No, it's Mars.
It's Mars.
Yeah. everything rubefacient is Mars. Though your rubefacience is probably due to a Scorpio rising. But your rubefacience definitely is not a blushing type. I just so appreciate it. I like that double Mars that you've got, because I can say anything. I can be wide open, and you're strong enough that you'll handle it. Yeah, and you've got the right intellectual appreciation for all of that. Anybody who says that all of that Mars is crude is